Hey, welcome to the Kennett Flash. How are you doing tonight? All right. Are you ready to laugh? Yes, we are going to laugh tonight. My name is Andrew Miller, and I am the managing director here at the Flash. I welcome you. Let me ask by a show of hands, is anybody here for the first time tonight? Any first timers? This is awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming. Let me tell you about the Kennett Flash. The Kennett Flash is a nonprofit performing arts center right here in Kennett Square, Pennsylvania. One of the biggest parts of our mission is to bring people together, young and old, from around the area, from Downingtown, Pennsylvania, yes, from Westchester, from Wilmington, Delaware, from Newark, Delaware, bring people from all around the area, young and old, into Kennett Square to see what the arts are like in Kennett Square, and in specific, see what the arts are like in this room, where you're up close and personal with the artist. This is a performance that's different from other performances that you'll get at similar places where you would see similar shows. Very different than performances in Wilmington, very different than performance centers in Philadelphia. It's a special thing we have here at the Flash, and I ask you to think about it. Think about, and it's a great room for comedy, it's a great room for music. Think about maybe what's different about this room and spread the word for us. As a nonprofit, we have a very limited marketing budget and we need your help spreading the word. That word of mouth advertising is huge for us. Let people know about your experience that you have here tonight and consider coming back. We have these postcards on the table. We have some great shows coming up. We have a one-woman comedy show coming up next Friday night. We have comedy monthly. We have every second Thursday for 6 years running now, we have an improv comedy troupe called Better Than Bacon. They're hilarious, they're awesome, and we're so happy that they're a resident improv comedy troupe here at the Kennett Flash. Every third Thursday, we do a stand-up comedy show that is excellent, and you'll see performers on that stand-up comedy show very similar to the ones you'll see here tonight. So consider coming back and consider bringing some friends. Let me tell you what we need to be successful here at the Flash. We need to sell tickets, like I was saying. Ticket sales account for about 75% of our operating expenses, and that's directly from the sale of a ticket. That's not BYOB, that's not food service, it's selling tickets is how we stay open. The difference we make up through donations, sponsorships, and grants. And really small donations make a huge difference here at the Flash. If everybody who came to the Flash last year donated just $25 with their ticket purchase, that would cover 50% of our expenses in a year, and we don't need that much. So if you value these kind of performances, if you value the fact that we love to give local artists like Chris and his friends a chance to perform in a beautiful room, consider making a small donation on your way out. We value local performers here, and we want you to value them too. Consider making a small donation on your way out. $5 to $10 is gonna go a long way into continuing these kind of performances here at the Flash. The last thing I'll say before I get off the stage is about volunteers here at the Flash. I am the only regular employee of the Kennett Flash. Everybody else is either a very part-time sound guy or a volunteer. We have a volunteer board. We have volunteers that work the door. The Flash lives and dies by its volunteers. Without volunteers, I can't do it all by myself. And volunteering at the Flash is very easy. We have actually, I want to just note out before I continue, we have two great volunteers on the door tonight helping us out, Steve and Gene. Let's give them a round of applause for helping us out tonight. Volunteering at the Flash is very easy. It's once a month, maybe it's once every 3 or 4 months. You come in 4 or 5 hours of your time. You help a little bit before the show, help clean up a little bit after the show, help get people in during the show. It is so easy. There are additional volunteer opportunities besides just working the shows as well. But if you want to work a show, you're going to see a great show for free. We'll feed you dinner for free. But most importantly, you know you're helping a good cause in the Kennett Flash. So if you're interested in volunteering, check with me after the show. I can give you a little bit more information on that. Consider making a small donation on your way out. Take one of these postcards with you. Put it on your fridge when you get home, and consider coming back to the Flash. And thanks so much for your support tonight. It means a lot. We need it to keep going here in Kennett Square. I'm gonna get off the stage now because you didn't come to hear me ask for money and ramble on and on and on. I'm going to turn the stage over to Mr. Gene Meyer. Gene has opened for such acts as the Reverend Bob Levy and Stuttering John, formerly of the Howard Stern Show and the Tonight Show. Mr. Gene Meyer, have fun tonight, guys. Enjoy the show.
Are we doing? Are we good? Can I get a round of applause for that guy whose name I just completely forgot? How are we doing? I'm Gene. What's going on? Okay. So I'm really into heavy metal. Is anyone else into metal at all? Yeah! So I'm really into heavy metal. I'm really into this one type of genre. It's called death metal, which is a long way of saying I still live with my parents, right? And before, I go to shows like all the time, just about every day. And before every show I go to, my 58-year-old Jewish dad will ask me what band I'm seeing as if he might recognize their name, you know? Like, oh, Cannibal Corpse! Weren't they just on Jimmy Fallon the other night? It's like, no, Dad, that was Sheryl Crow, okay? We've had this conversation before. But yeah, so the other day, I asked my dad, I said, Dad, when did you start going bald? And without missing a beat, he said, the minute I married your mother. And as soon as he said it, Don Rickles came out of the kitchen pantry closet eating a Reuben, shook his hand, and left. That actually happened. That actually happened, man. And then a couple of weeks later, they came to see me do stand-up. And after the show, I was talking to my parents in the parking lot, and I said, what did you guys think? And right away, my mom was like, it was good, you just need to quit it with all the masturbation stuff. And right away, my dad was like, and she doesn't mean the jokes, oh! And Don Rickles came out of a parked car eating a turkey on rye, shook his hand, and left. That actually happened. One last dad joke. Are you on board with that? You look so scared right now. I yell my jokes so I don't have to hear people not laugh at them, okay? So, my dad is, he's a big Mets fan. I know, boo. Yeah, high five. Okay, all right, fine. And so I said, Dad, what was it like in 1986 as a Mets fan when they won the World Series? What was that like? And he said, I'll be honest, Gene, I was disappointed that there was nothing to complain about. And as soon as he said that, I was like, this is why Jewish people don't believe in hell. Because to them, the idea of heaven, a place so perfect there is nothing to complain about, is hell, you know? Like, oh my God, my every need is taken care of! Ugh! Thank you. Thank you for laughing at that. Don't clap. No, I'm kidding. I love it when you guys clap. So this is true. A couple of months ago, my great-grandmother passed away, right? I know. Great setup. She was 103 years old, right? Yeah. But up until the day she died, she claimed to only be 98 years old. As if there's some guy out there who's like, listen, I'd sleep with a 98-year-old, okay? But 103, that is too rich for my blood, Greta. During the funeral, the rabbi said, Greta was a Jewish woman of opinion. And we all burst out laughing because we knew he meant, you know, she was a bitch. So, she was. I mean, she really was. So, but, you know. God rest. Yeah, let's see. Oh, so I've been taking stand-up more seriously. I know. Why? Why have I hit? And the other day, I literally typed into Google how to be a better stand-up comedian. And the first result just said, clinical therapists available in your area. And I was like, ha, joke's on you. I already got one. Her name is Mom. All right. Yeah, and... I do stand up a lot like I do sex. It's short, it's loud, and I cry afterwards. Yeah. But here's the thing. No, don't. The thing is, I cry after sex, but it's not because I'm sad. I'm happy. I'm so proud of myself for not crying during it. Right? Do you get the irony? God, oh my God, I'm getting such disapproval from you. Is this what you did? Were you just like, I'm going to ruin a young man's night. I'm just gonna go out and I'm just gonna sit and just stare into his soul and crush him. I'm kidding, no, I love it. I love the energy. Give it up for this woman, come on. What's your name? I don't care. All right, so. I'm kidding. I do care. Well, okay, whatever. Let's see. I yell my jokes. Okay, this is my last joke, all right? And then we're going to get started with actual good comedy, okay? Thanks. Yay! Get him off the stage. Yay. Oh, my God. Is it hot up here, or am I just really bad at this? Okay. So, in the news lately, you know, I don't know if you guys have been watching the news. All right, we'll skip, no. I'll say this. I'm studying to be a social worker at Bryn Mawr. I'm getting my master's in it. And one thing we talk about is like this idea of like racial profiling by the police, right? And so it got me thinking, have I ever been racially profiled? And no, I can't say I have. But there was this time, 15 years ago, okay, 2002, when I was 11, thank you. It was holiday season. And I went to the Best Buy at the King of Prussia Mall, right? Right? As soon as I walk in, a guy working there walks up to me and says, "Excuse me, sir, I just think you should know that we have the new Linkin Park CD right over here." And I said, "Just because I'm a white 11-year-old boy does not mean I'm here to buy the new Linkin Park CD, okay? Now, where's that new Limp Bizkit CD, goddammit?" All right, are we ready to get this show started? All right. Up first, we have a beautiful... Ooh, this mic keeps cutting out. We have a beautiful young man. I've never met him before, but he's great. Please, keep that thunderous round of applause going for Nick Karabetsos, everyone.
That's pretty perfectly. So my name is Nick Karabetsos, and yes, before you ask, that is Chinese. And no, I will not spell it. So let's get into it, shall we? So I'm at the mall not too long ago with my lovely girlfriend, and whenever we go out, my name isn't Nick Karabetsos. It's here, hold this. And I'm like a baby about that. Like, I'll hold it, but this one time, I was defiant. I was like, I don't wanna. She was like, "Can you hold my wallet?" I was like, I don't wanna. She was like, "Can you please just hold my wallet for 1 second?" I was like, "No, I don't wanna hold your wallet." She was like, "Fine." And I was like, and then I felt like a shit. And I'm like, I won a battle that didn't need to be won. Why couldn't I just hold her wallet? So, you know, I was like, I felt bad. I was like, "All right, I'll take your wallet." She was like, "No, you don't want to hold it, I'll hold it." I was like, "Come on, just give me a wallet." "No, I don't want to hold it." "Come on, just give me a wallet." "No, come on." "Give me your wallet!" "Excuse me, ma'am, is this guy bothering you?" "Oh, no. Oh, God." So, and that kind of thing keeps happening to me. I keep getting caught in like awkward situations that I'd rather not be in. And a lot of them happen in bathrooms, which is awesome for me. So, one such incident, I'll tell you about it. This was a long time ago. I was a youngin'. I was in high school. And I go in the bathroom, and a lot of the men in here, you'll know as soon as I tell you what the setup was. There's two urinals. So, immediately the rule is in effect. I don't think I have to explain it. You guys know. All right. So, for those that need it explained. there's a rule in effect in the men's room that whatever amount of urinals there is, you leave the space. It's the buffer zone. It's the no man's land. So there's only two urinals in this bathroom. So I'm like, well, the rule's in effect, and I understand what's happening. The notable exceptions are sporting events and concerts. We just got to get in and get out. So I'm in there, and this guy comes in behind me who does not belong in a high school. He was like 47 and did not look, he wasn't like in the teacher's garb or like a janitor or anything. He was in like cargo shorts and like a Led Zeppelin t-shirt. I'm like, what? So he comes in, and I'll put my back to you to demonstrate what's happening here. So I'm here, and this is the empty urinal. So I'm doing my thing. All of a sudden, this guy comes in and starts using it. I was like, what the fuck? Okay. And then I start playing that game where you look literally everywhere but right here. And I'm like, oh, that's nice, stucco, that's nice, nice. Call Timmy's mom for a good time. Maybe I'll be in there. And he starts going. And I don't know what his setup was, but it was like pinching the end of a garden hose. I'm sitting here, you know, and I'm midstream. I'm committed. So he starts going, and it's like, and it's hitting the back of the urinal with such force. It's flying back out and hitting me in the side. I'm just like, I'm trying to keep my composure. And in my head, I'm like, ah! Ah! But outside, I'm cool. I'm collect. Right? I'm Travolta after he blows that guy's head off in Pulp Fiction. Actually, he wasn't collect after that scene. I don't know why I said that. So he starts going, and this is the first time in my life I ever did this, and I'll never do it again. I stopped. It was like, and I was like, ah! I was like, Marines, we are leaving! And I like zip up, and I like do like a barrel roll around him and run into the stall and go in the stall. And I didn't, I was like thinking about me because I'm selfish. And I didn't think about how weird this would have been for this guy. Like, he's just going to the bathroom, and all of a sudden this guy just goes, for no reason. Like, he's like, I don't know what the big deal is. This guy's being, you know. So that happened. It was not a great time for me, and I had a towel off later. So the other such incident happened at my job. I work in the city, and there in the morning, I get there early, and I can use the bathroom in privacy. And but one time I wasn't in there alone, and I was in the stall, and there was another guy in the stall. I'm in there, he comes in, does his thing, leaves, doesn't wash his hands, and I look under the stall and I see the combination of pant and shoe that I know I'm not shaking hands with later. So he leaves, and I come out, and it was like, whoa! Like, this guy destroyed it. I wanted to find him and like congratulate him, but I didn't, because he would have known that I knew it was him. So he didn't wash his hands, and the bathroom stunk, and I'm washing my hands now, and another guy comes in, and he comes in, and he goes like this. And then he looks at me, and he's like, keeps going. I'm like, no, that wasn't me. That was the other guy. No. And I don't want to out the other guy as like the bathroom destroyer who doesn't wash his hands, because I'm in a professional environment, and I have to keep my shit together. It's not fair. Exactly, thank you. So, and one of the another series of awkward events is me on my commute to work. So I go through Suburban Station in the city, and there's all manner of people in there, you know, bustling about their day. There's a lot of homeless people, and a lot of people just hanging out with nothing to do. So I'm walking through, and I had just gotten a haircut, you know, looking fresh. So I walking down the little corridor to get to my elevator to go up to work. And this guy stands up. He's like sitting kind of like this, and he has on black pleated Dickies shorts, like a black button down, and a dog collar. Not a choker, a dog collar. This man was wearing a dog collar and like a painter's cap or something. I don't know what you call it. It's like boxy with a little brim. And he stands up, and in this big thundering voice, this like older black gentleman, he goes, "You looking good in that suit." And I was like, me? Thank you. And I kept walking, just, you know, whatever, just deal with it and go. And then the same day, I walk back, and he sees me, and he's like, hey, and I'm like, hey, you're the guy that said I look good in my suit. Thanks. just keep walking. God, I can't deal with that. Ugh. So I was like, hit on. It felt weird as a man. I'm sure you ladies deal with that, and I sympathize with the struggles you have to go through, because that's not fun. I don't like that. It makes me feel good about myself. So it happened again with another guy, also older black gentleman. I guess I'm just one of those faces. I don't know. So I'm walking. He doesn't say anything to me. He just goes, just whistles. And I was like, and I'm like, there's no one around. I'm like, who's he whistling at? I'm like, there's nobody behind me. And there's no other better looking gentleman around. I'm like, wait, was that for me? I turn around, I was like, hey! And he's like, what? And I was like, I am not some piece of meat that you can whistle at, buddy. I'm not here for your enjoyment. Thank you. And I strolled away, feeling empowered. It was good. It felt it was a victory for us ladies. So another such incident is, on the weekends, I deliver a pizza for some extra cash, you know, in this today's economy. And I went to an apartment, and two gay gentlemen wanted to buy me. And I'll tell you that story. So I get up into their apartment, and this woman answers the door, and she has kind of like, there's something like happened to her arm, and it didn't grow. I don't know. And that was not meant to sound as awful as it did. I was just trying to explain that she had a gimpy arm. So me being the nice guy, you know, I was like, oh, would you like me to carry the food inside for you? She's like, oh, yes, if you could, that would be great, thank you. And we get inside, and she immediately yells, oh, my God, don't look in there! And I was like, whoa! And I look in there, because why wouldn't I? And there's like a gentleman, he's in the bathroom, he's peeing, but he's clothed, and he's not facing me. I went to college, I've seen people pee. It's not a big deal. So I go in, and this guy sitting at like a computer hears me and wheels around and is like, ooh, hello. And I was like, hello, sir. And the lady's like, oh, don't mind him. You can just put the food on the stove. I go to turn, put the food on the stove, and I see before me, on the stove of all places, the juiciest jelly red dildo you've ever seen in your life. It was like triumph. It was like defying gravity. It was standing, it was like, like, that's its posture. This dildo had posture. And I'm startled by it. You know, I'm trying to be adult about it, so I'm not gonna freak out like a 12-year-old, but I like shake a bit, and I hit the oven, and it kind of like, and it jiggles. So I'm like, I gotta breeze right past this. I can't deal with this right now. So I put it like on the chair or wherever, and in walks the other guy as they ask me, so how much is it? And he comes in, and he goes, oh, how much are you? I was like, what do you got? I'm broke. I do this on the side for money. What? I got loans to pay. Come on. This college was expensive. So the lady goes, oh, stop it. Don't bother with them. You know, here's your money. And then the guy number one sitting at the computer says, did you know that she was in a film called Queen of the Desert? I was like, why would I know that? And he goes, in the movie, she has a scene where she takes a ping pong ball and she puts it, and she goes, stop it, oh my God, stop it. He doesn't want to hear that. He doesn't want to hear that. Not, oh, that's not true, don't tell him that. He doesn't want to hear that. That happened. I know that this woman did that on film for money. I was like, I just got to get the hell out of here. I'm not judging. Like, people do what they do, and, you know, whatever you're into, that's fine. I'm not like one of those people that's like, everyone says that. So, and it's weird how people, you know, come on to each other, how people like whistle at people or people hit on each other. And I think we should take a page from the animal kingdom. The female red North American fox, when she is in heat, will make a noise, and it sounds like someone being stabbed to death. To my impression for you all, whether you like it or not. That's what it sounds like. And if you hear that in the night, someone's either being murdered or there's a fox feeling foxy. So, it's true, I'm not making that up. YouTube it at your own risk. So, I was like, why can't we adopt that? Like, animals have like their seduction dances, and birds have like feathers and all this stuff. It would be so much easier. There would be no doubts about how people felt about each other if women just walked down the street, had their phone out. Just some hot guy walks by, you know. Yeah, Chelsea, yeah, I'm gonna meet up with Chelsea later. Yo, girl, we're gonna have dinner. Stupid. So, I have a knock-knock joke for you guys. Knock-knock.
Who's
there? Fuck mosquitoes. Yes. I think... Sorry, that was the end of the joke. I didn't do a good job of setting that up. I'm sorry. I failed you all. So mosquitoes, I think that's the thing that's going to unite the world. Doesn't matter what your religious beliefs are, who you voted for, what country you come from. Everybody fucking hates mosquitoes. Nobody loves them. What good are they? They don't do anything. This isn't a joke. I just hate mosquitoes. So speaking of vermin that should be wiped off the face of the planet, the Westboro Baptist Church was in town during the election, and it was a great time for all involved. Except it wasn't. So, the office I work at looks down on City Hall, and they had attended a gay pride march the night before. They never miss a gay pride event, go figure. So, they're out there with their signs, you know, they're like, gay sex is sin, and, you know, we're all burning in hell, whatever. But the only people out there to receive this message, and it was just like kind of during the summer, are just a bunch of kids playing in the fountains out front of City Hall. I'm like, this is the crowd, guys? You got them? Get them while they're young. Tobacco industry. Boom. Kid can't read, but he's going to grow up knowing gay sex is sending people to hell. Damn it. So, and who was out there to meet them, to kind of counter their protest? Philly Jesus. Philly Jesus himself. So if those of you who don't know who Philly Jesus is, he's like this strung out, like heroin addict-y homeless guy, like matted hair and this crazy beard, wears sandals and a robe all the time, and he just goes out in the fountains and just kind of walks through them like, come to me, my children! And he has like this big cross that he made in his basement. I don't know. So he's out there and he's like blessing them and they're screaming in his face. They're like, fuck you, you're impersonating Jesus. I'm like, what do they know? He could be. What if that's actually Jesus come back and we're just like, this friggin' insane guy over here thinks he's Jesus. And it's like, no wonder he hasn't made himself aware. We'd think he was a nutcase. Coming back like, I am the risen Jesus. Like, yeah, me too, buddy. Whatever. So, anyway, he's out there like yelling at them. And there's no police involvement. And it's like, oh God, it's so awkward and horrible. So they leave. After a while they leave. So Philly Jesus is like, I won. So he's just like kind of walking around doing his thing. And I don't get it. I don't know what the deal is. Parents love this guy. They're like, oh, go play with him, Timmy. Like, go run out into the wet water with him. I'm not going to watch. I'm just going to sit here and sip my Diet Coke and not pay attention to me on my phone and not look at you alone with this guy who's homeless and gets arrested all the time, who thinks he's Jesus. It's like perfectly fine. They're like, yeah, they'll learn a lesson from him. It'll be great. They'll love it. I'm like, well, they're going to learn a lesson, all right. Jesus. I have a theory about him. I think that he's actually not like this crazy homeless guy. Like, he does it purposefully. Like, he's actually like this extremely wealthy trust fund kid who just does this for kicks. Like, his dad, like, left the family years ago with millions. It's like, I'm moving to Peru with my mistress. Don't follow me. And making this up, this didn't happen. So, and the mom is like, you know, just totally out of her gourd 24/7. She's like, Bob must be back by noon for dinner. Bring me a mojito, really. He's like, Mom, I'm going out with my friends, okay? Just leave me alone. Storms out, soon he's out the door, new persona. He's Jesus now. Comes back in. She's like, how was the concert? I didn't go to a concert, Mom. God! Goes into his room, slams the door, and listens to Beastie Boys really loud. That's what he wants to do with his life. So, God. So one more story. One more story for you guys to kind of wrap up here. So, for my job, I have to talk to people on the phone a lot. And this guy called in, and he was kind of like strung out, kind of deranged, and he was clearly looking for like medicine. I'm being polite, he's looking for drugs. So he was like, yeah, man, you know, I'm just going through some hard times, man. I'm just wondering if you guys can get me a little something. I was like, I can't do that for you, nor will I. And so he was like, well, what can you do for me, man? I was like, did you go to a doctor? Do you have a doctor? He's like, I went to a doctor 2 years ago. I was like, oh, good, great, it's going to work out. So I'm stupid, I three-way call this guy with the doctor. The doctor answers the phone, and he's like, yeah, I'm not going to give him anything. He's a pill grabber. Yeah, he's a drug addict. I won't see him. I was like, oh, don't say it while I'm on the phone with him. I'm going to have to deal with that later. Ugh. So he puts us on the longest hold, like 17 minutes. And so this guy starts chatting with me about my life while there's this really like upbeat like jazz music playing. So it becomes like this weird bohemian beatnik like avant-garde word performance for this guy for me. So I'm hearing like stand-up bass, like, and he's just yammering away over. He's like, so picture the bass in your head, and this guy's like, yeah, man. So you know, it's just I go outside, you know, man, and my girlfriend, she's tried to like kill me 10 times, and I support her, man. Like I do all this stuff. Yeah, man. You know what I'm saying, man? That's what, I was like, yeah, I know what you're saying. Totally. Just God. So the doctor finally answers the phone and he's like, yeah, maybe we can get him in, I don't know, we'll see. And he just hangs up. I was like, that was productive. So I was like, I don't know, if you're in pain, dude, I guess go to a hospital. I don't know what to tell you. And he's like, oh yeah, I'll go to a hospital, I'll try that. Like, oh yeah, I didn't think of that idea. No, just go to the hospital if you're in pain. Don't try that to score drugs. Oh my God. And then I didn't hang. But I really wanted to. So he finally goes away, never to hear from him again. I don't know what happened to this guy. He's out there roaming the wastes of the world, just like, pills. And I feel bad, you know, I'm sure he's in a bad spot and all that, but that's just how it is sometimes, you know? So, all right, I think I've given you guys enough torture for one evening. I don't have any big climax. I'll avoid the obvious sex joke. All right. I would like to welcome Gene Meyer back out onto the stage to continue hosting this marvelous event. And I thank you all for being here for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. One more time for Nicholas Karabetsos. Yeah, see? I just want to point out, after he did the first fox mating call, I heard someone over here say, yeah, I've heard that before. Was that you? I was trying to stifle laughter backstage. It's all right, Mom. Okay, so up next, we have a beautiful young man. He's a hot up-and-coming Philly comic. I was, in May, I was part of a contest that he won. So you know he's good, yeah. He is a sophomore at Temple, maybe? Yeah, Temple! Go Owls! Go Birds! Go team! He's very funny. Please keep it going for Mr. Ethan Miller, everyone.
Tonight, people. If anybody ever tells you you're old, tell them fuck off, you're not, okay? Because what we got here looks like we got young people. This is a young crowd, I see. Handsome. Hey, he's a keeper. Look at him. Hello. See you later, right? So, just want to let you guys know, I'm your degenerate of the night. 20 years old, sophomore at Temple University. Any Temple in the house? All right. Temple. All right. There go the boys. Listen, Temple, good place. Basketball team sucks. Football team's killing it. So we get best of both worlds, right? I want to talk about one thing before I get started. I want to let everybody know, break the ice real quick. I am a Jew. Oh, wow. We got claps. All right. Not bad. As long as I don't get tomatoes thrown at me, I'm fine. All right? Biggest thing in my college career so far is my problem with Xanax. I've been taking way too much Xanax. I don't know if it's Xanax or if it's the weed brownies. And meanwhile, I ate a weed brownie earlier in the day, thinking I wouldn't be stoned, and I'm absolutely so high up here, so bear with me if I forget anything. But they, my boys are like, oh, it's fine, you'll find it'll wear off, it'll wear off. Well, it's not, so I'm high, and I'm very comfortable. But anyways, to move on, I don't know if it's, she's shaking her head, these kids, I can't take them, I'll be saying the same thing in 10 years. 40 years. Well, when I have kids in 10 years, you know, I hope, God forbid, you know, hopefully, see where my life takes me. But move on. I'm rambling here. So, the Xanax, I don't know if it's Xanax or if it's the weed brownies that's messing up my memory. I'm not a doctor, and I'm sure as hell not going to the doctors, because you know what happens if I go to the doctors? They're going to say, Ethan, stop taking Xanax. I'm going to say no. They're going to contact my parents. My parents are going to find out. Once my parents find out, they're going to say, Ethan, are you taking Xanax? I'm going to say no. They're going to know I'm lying. Then they're going to drug test me. And then I'm going to fail the drug test. They're going to take me out of school. Once they take me out of school, they're going to put me in rehab. Once they put me in rehab, I'll be a loser sitting on their couch with no education and no friends. So, moral of the story is here that I should stop taking Xanax, and I really should, because, you know, it's not a good thing, to be honest. It's really not. It really, really does mess up your memory. As you can see right now, I'm like, what the fuck, what am I even saying? But I don't want to be that loser sitting on the couch, so I'm just going to, you know, not tell the doctors that it's Xanax that's fucking up my memory, because, to be honest, I'm perfectly content with Xanax, alcohol, and a blowjob from 250-pound chick Kathy from Doylestown on my Thursday, Friday, and Saturdays. Okay, people? Anybody from Doylestown? Because I'm telling you, this Kathy girl gets a great blowjob. And if anybody needs one, I will hand it off. The husband's laughing. He's like, guys, come on. I'm telling you, if you need one, it's cheap. Okay? Another thing. Xanax isn't the only thing that I have a problem with. It's weed. Weed's another drug. America is so desensitized at this point. You know, when I come home from college, my 80-year-old grandmother cleans my bong. Ethan, how many times do I have to tell you to clean out the water in the bong? I'm not there with you at college. You have to clean it out or you're not going to get a good hit. And I'm sick of listening to your mother bicker in my ear 24/7 talking about how you're going high to math class because Professor Weinberg won't stop emailing her telling her you're stoned in class. So cut the bullshit out. Okay, so that's my 80-year-old grandmother. Let's keep that applause up. Let's give it a quick applause for all the war veterans out there right now. Let's give it an applause, seriously, because you now when I was the Trump in office and all that, he's very big on. Listen, I'm not gonna get into politics. I'm a young guy. We're not gonna do that right now. Okay, we're not gonna do that. But listen, those guys put their lives on the line, and you're fucking crazy. If you think I would go out there, you're nuts. If I went out there, I would 100% go high, because either way, I'm dying. So I'm ripping the bong before we go out. Let's go, boys, we're out. I'm ripping the bong, we go. Okay? But it's just, if I go out there stoned, I'm definitely not coming back. And if I don't go out there stoned, I'm definitely not coming back. So either way, if I go out there, I'm not coming back. That's the moral of the story here. And I just want to talk about, this is a big thing, because it's true. I have a friend who's actually enlisted in the Army. And to be honest, I was like, listen, I may just enlist in the Army. You know, the grades aren't going well. You know, I'm smoking too much weed, the Xanax. Nothing's really going right for me, so I might as well just enlist. And he's like, you won't fucking make it. So I'm not doing it. It's over with. That dream is over with. But there's this kid to the right of me in class, my Mosaic class, bringing everybody back to college. Let's bring everybody back to college for a second. Okay? There's this guy to the right of me in class. He cannot start a sentence. I shit you not. He cannot start a sentence without saying, ah. I'm like, yo, buddy, what's going on? How was your weekend? What'd you do? He'll be like, ah. Not much, dude. Ah. Got stoned, hung out with my girlfriend. Oh, I got stoned more. I got so sick and tired of hearing him do that. I was like, dude, what's good with the He's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, what do you mean, what am I talking about? This, that, then. Everything's with you. How in the world are you going to get a job starting every sentence like, He's like, you want to keep cheating off me in class? Then I suggest you shut the fuck up. But I'm like, I guess he has a point, right? I guess he has a point. If I want to cheat and I want to get through, then all you want. I don't care. Do what you got to do. Listen, college parties, people, disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. It's embarrassing. Anybody got kids in college right now? Anybody? Anybody? No. Pray for them, Lord, please. Pray for them. I go into these college parties, and you people are actually insane if you think that us men are the only ones that want sexual action, okay? I see girls, I'll get into the guys in a sec, but the girls, I see girls automatically going onto the dance floor, and they're on all fours already, shaking their butt like this. I'm like, oh, you're women, relax, okay? You don't go out and you don't shove that out there for the men, okay? The guys, listen, 98% of the time, it's men's fault if there's any sexual action on the dance floor. I watch, I see everything, okay? You know why? Because women don't approach men. Men approach women. Yeah. Right, unless it's me. I'm a pussy. I don't approach women. I just can't. We'll talk about my confidence goes in a sec. But I see guys, you know, little Johnny on the opposite side of the dance floor thinks he's slick. I see little Johnny trying to get his. You don't think I see little Johnny like this trying to get his? Listen, relax. All I'm saying is, here's the dance floor. We need a little corner of the dance floor for all those people that want to do this and want to do this, because some of us like me, just want to come on the dance floor and be like, party bitches! That's it. Not everything has to be sexual, goddammit. Relax. Take a chill pill. It doesn't have to be this and that all the time. It could just be like this. It could just be like this. It doesn't have to be all this. You know what I mean? I mean, all right. Before I get on, because I know you guys are here to see Chris tonight. Before I get off. You see? I told you the fucking weed brownie. Shit. Getting denied. I get denied a lot. A lot. I think it's because I'm short. Hairy. I don't know. Maybe because I tell them I'm a Jew from the start and they just walk away. I don't know what it is. But once I get denied, once, I don't go back. Okay? Just know that. I don't go back. My mother told me right. Ethan? No means no. No doesn't mean go back. No doesn't mean she wants you. No means she doesn't fucking want you. And I don't feel like dealing with a fucking lawsuit. So don't go near a girl when she says no. So I took her advice. Thank you. You know, once a girl says no, get away. Move on. I see guys looking like zombies out here trying to get girls, okay? Going up to girls. Like creepy like this, and I'm like, you look so good. Oh my God, get the fuck away from me. What are you doing, you pervert? Right, we got guys like that. 5 minutes later, girl's over there still, same guy going up to the girl. This time, the hand's out. The hand's doing his hand action now. He's got, you know. So he touches her waist. You look so good. Oh my God, get the fuck away from me. One more time, and I'm calling the police, and we're gonna have a problem. So he's no longer, this guy, I'm telling you, you guys think I'm kidding? Come to a college party. Come to Temple University, and you'll see, okay? This guy's no longer going up to girls, but now he's in the corner, and he's like, you look so good. Okay, so, no means no. Don't do any, if there's any young people, my guys, no, no means no. Don't do any of that stuff. Last thing, because you need some young talent up here, you know what I mean? I don't want to say this is talent, because it's far from it, but. Last thing, I'm a complainer. I'm a complainer, people. I'm one of those people just bitching, moaning, whether it's about girls, whether it's about too short, just because I'm hairy, whether it's because of, you know, my gambling addiction. That I'm definitely not telling my mom and dad about. Or whether it's about my illegal Muslim friend who's about to get shipped out of the country because Donald Trump is now president. I'm always bitching. about anything. But listen, I got a cut on the inside of my right hand, I would say a few months ago. And I went around to everybody, I'm like, listen, I can't jerk off, I got a cut on the inside of my right hand, and nobody gave a shit. No, I went around, nobody gave a shit. Oh, you can't jerk off? Well, what if you couldn't fucking jerk off, okay? What would you do? I started going around Temple University's campus, and I started humping things. I was humping trash cans, I was like, yeah. People were like, what is he doing? Everybody knew. He's like, he's got a cut on the inside of his hand, he can't jerk off. And people were like, ah, that makes sense, gotta get your nuts some way. Listen, guys, I'm Ethan Miller, thank you very much. Listen, Chris is gonna be great. Have a good night. Follow me on social media, EthanMiller215.
One more time for Ethan Miller. As soon as he said, I go to Temple, someone on this side of the room again was very aggressively like, This is not an Eagles game, okay? Calm down. This side of the room, there's something just spooky about you guys. No, keep it up. I love it. I love the energy. All right, are you guys ready for your next comic? Your next comic, I know him pretty well. He's a huge nerd. He's a 42-year-old father of two, and he's wearing a t-shirt with a character from a Cartoon Network TV show. That's the best intro I could possibly give him. Please give a warm welcome to Mr. Marc Huppman, everyone.
How's everybody doing tonight? I love this town. I'm 43, actually, and I'm old enough that when I come to a town like this, it's awesome because you get to the edge of town and you can start to remember like where streets didn't used to be paved. And it is. I mean, this was always like the sticks to me, and I get here and there are traffic lights everywhere now, and I'm like, wow, I'm getting old. I remember where shit wasn't. But, I'm wearing a humorous election shirt because I have to be honest, this has been the funniest fucking election ever. I laughed the entire time. It was a goddamn reality TV show episode. This was hilarious right up until about 11 o'clock Tuesday night. Yep. I remember I was at an open mic with Gene. And we're watching the TV, and people are starting to yell. And I'm like, you know what, I can't do this. I'm going to go home and go to sleep and hope this all blows the fuck over. And I woke up on Wednesday morning, and it hadn't. I was like, oh, no. So I quit cigarettes 12 years ago, but the first thing I did Tuesday morning was I woke up, I drove to Wawa, and I bought a carton of Parliament menthol lights. Because all of a sudden, like, long-term health care seemed to be more optimism than I could muster. I just don't have it in me. I think I'm going to be dead long before cancer sets in, and if I'm not, my bad. I took another bad vote, you know? But stuff is awesome. I am a nerd. And when you're 20, when you're like Ethan's age, like that's prison. That's a terrible thing to be 20 and a nerd. I'm 43 years old. Like, you know what? Write that shit on the fucking memo line of my paycheck. I don't care. It's fine now. I love it. I wouldn't do anything over if you paid me. But like, the awesome thing about being a nerd in this century is like I'm living in the future. Tonight, I took my son to get his phone fixed, and on the way out of the mall, I sold my old broken phone, I shit you not, to a robot. Sold my broken phone to a robot, and I'm like, holy shit, this is like Jetson stuff to me. And then there's this thing at Amazon. Amazon wants to deliver their things with drones. I think, who wants to get shit with a drone? Like, who wants stuff to come to their house on a little magic helicopter? I want that. And like, I have Amazon Prime, I'm not in a huge rush to get my stuff. I just want to say that I live in the only country in the world where the worst possible outcome of a drone strike is that I get a Kindle. Now, the other thing that Amazon has now, watch this shit. The other thing that Amazon has now is something called a dash button. Who's heard of the dash button? Two people. Yeah, they're marketing the shit out of this thing. It's a magic button. And they'll sell it to you for things like laundry detergent. You know, so if you're running out of a consumable, you just push this magic button, and the next day the shit shows up at your door. That is awesome. But they make it for Doritos. If you need a magic button to streamline your Dorito supply chain, they should probably make one for bongs too. I push the button, I don't even smoke pot. Just be like, hey, look, it comes to my house. No, but I am, I'm married now, you know. Marriage is awesome. I've been married for 16 years. Who here has been married for a long time? Round of applause. How long? You. 28 years, so you know what I'm going to say. They're not all good years. There are a shit ton of bad, I don't care who you are. You can either agree with this or lie. It's up to you. There are some bad years. And like at one point, I thought my wife was going to leave. I'm like, oh shit. This is terrible. I went and I talked to a lawyer about a divorce. I'm like, you know, he came back to me. He said, I want to encourage you to go to marriage counseling. Now, I was touched because here I am talking to somebody who deals in human misery. And he thinks I have a chance. He's seen everything. He thinks I've got a chance. I said, you really think we could make it? And he looked down for a second. He looked up. He said, no, Mr. Huppman. I really think you need a lot more time to save up for a divorce. So I went home and I did some homework. I looked it up. It's about $15,000. Who's been divorced here? $15,000 minimum. Now, 3 years ago, I buried my father for $10,000. So I'm just gonna wait it out because it's obviously cheaper that way. All right, that was a mixed bag. You know, but things are awesome. I took him up on his advice. You know, my wife and I, we went to marriage counseling. And you can learn a lot from a marriage counselor. You can learn that it's better to be happy than to be right. Like, let the argument go. You don't have to win every time. You can learn that sometimes your wife doesn't need you to solve a problem when she tells you about something. She just wants you to look her in the eye and say, I understand and I hear you. That's it. Sometimes you might learn that you're a piece of shit alcoholic. And that's kind of where we went with that one. So I quit. You know, everything I quit, this is going back 14 years now, drinking, getting high all the time. And it was, it's pretty awesome. Like, it makes a huge difference. The first difference it makes is I have to find a whole new way to be cool and find a bunch of new friends because, like, the change is everything. But here's the thing about alcohol. Alcohol is awesome. Alcohol gives people the best ideas in the world. That is the best thing about alcohol. Like, who here has ever been drunk and had a great idea? Right. The worst thing about alcohol is you do that shit. I have never woken up in a hospital or under a table and had a sober person come up to me and say, yeah, you ran that shit by me last night and I green-lighted it. Never happened. So now I have to own my bad ideas. And run it right in, right from there, we'll go right into kids. We tried for, it took us a couple years to have kids, so we're going back now. My oldest son is 10, and you know, fertility specialist, everything. We tried and tried and tried. And thrilled to have our first son. We named him Max. And that was like our second date. My wife told me if we had a son, we had to name him Max. And we stuck with it. And Max is awesome, you know, but here's the thing about kids. Like, Max is 10, he plays a lot of video games. And I watch kids play games and they're all really too easy. Like, we lower the bar for our kids. These games are really easy. I saw an ad on TV for Operation, the board game. And it said, now with easier to remove parts. You can look that up. It's on YouTube. It's real. It's not made up. Operation doesn't need easier to remove parts. Like, I want a game with consequences. I want a game that teaches Max about life, about decisions, and if he loses an operation, I really think he should have to march out into a waiting room and explain to some poor guy's family what the fuck just went wrong. It was a very difficult procedure. I tried to take out his funny bone, but I touched the sides. I'm so sorry. That's how Max should learn, and I want him to learn like some adult decisions. So he's 10, he's in fourth grade. I let him play some games that are designed for older kids. He's been playing Grand Theft Auto for about six months now, and I'm really proud of him. Fourth grade, killing hookers at a 10th grade level. Now, we were sure, like, we were done. We were like a one and done family, and then 5 years later, after we gave away the crib and the changing table and the playpens and the clothes, 6 o'clock on a Saturday morning, my wife comes into the bedroom, wakes me up, and says, you know, holds up, you know, the stick, the pee stick, yeah, and says, we're pregnant. And my first thought was, oh, fuck. My second thought was, okay, we'll go with it. It is 6 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday. I'm pretty sure you're still gonna be pregnant at 10. I'm going back to sleep.
This is why they're asking for donations.
But it's great because I'm a family man now. You know, we went to Disney recently. From 2.5 hours on a plane. The cool thing, here we go. I finally fulfilled a lifelong fantasy.
Fast forward 10 years.
I joined the Mile High Club. Woo! You guys all know what the Mile High Club is. Where the fuck were you when somebody was supposed to tell me you're supposed to join with somebody else? Little known fact. When they catch you masturbating on an airplane, you do get to join another club. They call it the no-fly list. So guess who's driving to Disney next year? And before you say it, I usually like to start with this. You may have noticed, I look like Stephen King. I look like a very specific Stephen King. I look like the Stephen King from that one episode of Sons of Anarchy where he gets rid of a body. But, so we're, you know, the plane's great, though. The other thing about the plane is we sit my son down, you know, he's 5 years old, and we put a movie on the iPad, and he sits still for 2.5 hours watching an iPad. I'm thinking, oh, that's great. To keep a kid still, all you gotta do is engage him, entertain him. No. To keep a kid still, you gotta put a seatbelt on him. That's really the trick. And I learned this the hard way in a movie theater.
Here we go.
I look away for a minute. I'm watching the movie. I'm into it. I turn around, 1 minute later, that kid wandered off like a tiny fucking Alzheimer's patient. And I mean it, I found him a mile down the road. He's in a convenience store, buying scratch-off tickets, mumbling racist shit about the Korean store owner. Awful. Awful, awful stuff. But I'm going to tell you guys this one thing, and then I'm going to get out of here. I'm used to getting out of speeding tickets. 43 years old, I've got a good driving record, I'm white. But recently I got a ticket for talking on my phone in New Jersey. Apparently you're not allowed to have your phone in your hand in New Jersey and talk on the phone.
Right.
I didn't know that. So I'm on the phone with my friend John. And I'm driving down the road and the lights come on behind me. I said, John, I gotta let you go. I'm getting pulled over. And I give the officer my driver's license and I give him my registration. And I give him my smartphone because that's where there's an app with my insurance card on it. And 5 minutes later, he comes back with a ticket. And I said, officer, can we let this one slide? And he said, normally, Mr. Huppman, I would. But you got this text from your friend John. And it said, you should probably tell that pig to go fuck himself in the donut hole. I had to eat that ticket. Kennett, please be kind. I know I normally tell everybody don't forget to tip your waitress and waiters and bartenders. We don't do that here. So fuck that guy who asked for money. Tip each other and have a great night.
One more time for Marc Huppman, everyone. Who was conjuring ghosts here that caused that to happen? Did I not say that this was the spooky side of the audience? That was some spooky shit, okay? Please, whatever you're doing, I'm sorry. Tell Satan my bad, we good, okay? All right, hopefully that won't happen again, but if it does, we know who to blame. All right, up next is a very hilarious comedian. She runs a monthly show in Allentown called Comedy Without Limits. I see this guy getting really excited. Are you excited? I'm excited. Yeah, yeah. please give a very warm welcome for Jillian Chiaro, everyone.
Videography is not in the Kennett Flash budget. I gotta do this myself. Alright, what's going on, everybody? Hey, how are ya? This is my first kind of like theater show. This is pretty cool. I'm not very good with makeup, but I really wanted to try hard, and I kind of look like a YouTube makeup tutorial gone wrong, but I'm trying. Thank you. But no, I usually my thing is wearing the dark red lipstick, and it's the weirdest thing to have people approach you just about lipstick all the time. Like, I just hate people that like take makeup too seriously and think is what I want, and I don't mean like people that like spend hours on their makeup. Like, I love that shit. Like, you do you, girl. But I had a woman come up to me and she was like, wow, you're so daring. I would never dare to wear red lipstick. Yeah. I went to Target and purchased this Wet n' Wild color for $1.99. I'm a real woman warrior. Thank you. I'm only 20 as well. This has been sort of the year that I've really been focusing on taking care of mental illness issues, that sort of thing. And you know, the thing. So it was really weird, the stuff I got diagnosed with. Like, well, first off, I got diagnosed with anxiety, which is like, duh. When I was 9, I brought free weights to a slumber party because I worried that if I went one day without doing my little arm workouts that I read in Cosmo magazine, that my arms would never look like Nicole Richie's. Speed it up 11 years later, they still don't. But the weird one I got diagnosed with was situational depression, which, like, I didn't know that was a thing, and more so I didn't know the situation was anywhere I physically am, 24/7, 365 days a year. No, the thing that kind of like aggravated, like I do like my therapist a lot, but what aggravates me with her is that like she doesn't believe the fact that like I'm a comedian. Like she can't be like, wow, like you know, like with your self-esteem issues, like some people that are like as sad as you can never get on stage like that. So, like, to get her to believe me, I started tap dancing into sessions. Guess who looked at her ex-boyfriend's Facebook 9 times today? I wanted to go to therapy when I was, like, younger, but my parents didn't believe in it. Their alternative to therapy was, like, here's Lou Reed's LP transformer. Go to your room. No, my parents are great. I'm not from around here. I live up in towards the Poconos, like northeastern PA. So like, you know, like this is so cool to be around here, but I don't really like the where I live, basically. I live in Goldsboro, that's the name of the town. And to give you an idea of what it's like, I want you all to picture just a cabin in the woods, family living in a cabin in the woods. And now I want you to picture what their isolationist uncle looks like living in his bomb shelter 15 miles away that's only, you know, able to get to by foot. And that's what Goldsboro is. Like, I don't even, like, I don't understand what their idea of, you know, why they decided to raise a family. They're like, you know, should we like raise our family in, like, a town with, like, culture and things going on? Nah. Let's raise her in the woods. We'll just write catty things on her Facebook when she's 16 to discipline her. Thanks for coming home at 5 a.m., Jillian. But I do love my mom. I still live at home, and one of the perks of living at home is like they still buy groceries, that sort of thing, so like, you know, I can save up money. But I get pretty fed up with my mother's food shopping, I will say that. My mom likes to discount shopping, and I don't mean like Target or Walmart, I mean like flea markets. And you know, it'll mount up because, like, I don't want to, like, immediately throw it away on her because, like, I'll figure out that, like, oh, it's expired, but she's, you know, that sort of thing. And, you know, finally, after, like, a while of mounting up, like, I've said to her, like, you know, what are you going to do? Like, this is too much. Like, will you keep buying expired food? Like, why can't you understand this is expired? Well, I don't want to wear glasses like you do, Jillian. I don't want to look like a nerd. And, yeah, I figured out where she was buying all this crazy stuff, and, you know, it was kind of like seeing the heroin dealer that killed your son. It was like one of those things where I was like, how could you have done this to my family? Why do you still have Christmas M&M's in July. But, she'll, like, drop, like, subtle hints, though. I'll catch it. Like, one weekend she came home with 10 lean cuisines. It's like, yeah, I knew I was hitting that breakup hard, Mom, but you don't have to go that far. 10 lean cuisines. But no, it's fun, because she's, like, trying to be, like, the cool, hip mom now. She's always, like, a very strict mom. And, she's talking about getting, like, a tattoo, like, all this other stuff. The other, not too long ago, we were watching, like, a Netflix documentary about drugs, and she goes, you know, I would really like to try a pop brownie. And before I could, like, even think about, you know, what to say to that, my mind went to, like, I wonder how many points on Weight Watchers a pop brownie would be for her. Gotta think that one over. So I think we're getting a little close here, guys. So I think I could let a little secret out with you. I met a boy. Yeah, I met a boy. He's very the different kind of guy, though. Like, I'm... it's just like how like I feel around him. Like, usually I'm very calm and collected, and I started to notice that like he made me very nervous by a very one extreme situation that happened not too long ago. And it was that we were like saying goodbye, and we weren't like really at the phase of like hugging each other, you know, we're taking it slow. I was saying goodbye, and what I wanted to say was, hey, I'll see you later. But how it came out was, see you later. Get out. Where, like, what? Like, I do stand-up comedy, and that's, like, one of the scariest things for people, but, like, just talking to this one person, it's like the ghost of Chris Farley has, like, inhabited my soul. Just in those, you're pretty. Stupid. And like I pray I fall into a coffee table. But he's definitely a keeper. I do this thing, and I don't know if anyone else is like this too, where I sleep text. It's kind of in like the same vein of like sleepwalking, but like your brain is so aware that you can keep like texting while you're asleep. And he texted me just, hey, and I wrote back, sound asleep, why? I kind of feel bad about, because this is like definitely like the climate we're going through right now with everything in the world. Like, this is like the worst time to be like, I'm falling in love. You know what I mean? It's kind of like, yeah, the world's freezing over, but at least I have someone to cuddle to keep me warm. The only safe place I need is in his arms. Yeah, like I said, we were taking it slow. The last relationship I was in, it kind of went on too long, and like a bad thing happened where, you know, I was not really feeling this guy, but like a month into the relationship, his grandmother died. And, you know what I mean? Like, I don't want to be that jerk, but it's like, hey, I don't know her and I don't know you anymore. See ya. You know, like, that's not cool. But, the weirder part was the funeral, obviously. But, yeah, if any of you are out there, like, in, relationships right now, and you're thinking like, you know, really, what's the best place to meet the family? Like, I can give you the advice that grandma's funeral is not it. Not it at all. But people kept, like, they figured, like, they found out I was a comedian, so they would be coming up to me like, are you gonna put this in your act? No. Like, was it like, it was one of those things where it's like, you have a couple people, but like, everybody, like, four, like, you know, it's just 50 people, and like, it made me wonder, like, there's no way this was like her dying wish, you know what I mean? Like, I don't ever see her, you know, on her deathbed, like, you know, at my funeral, I want that girl Benjamin meant on the internet to be there and then make jokes about it so I can live on forever. Beep. Like that didn't happen. But now kind of what the final straw was, we stayed together about 4 months, and I didn't know he was kind of an insomniac, that he didn't fall asleep ever, and he went to temple as well, so he still lived with his parents and had a twin bed, and so, you know, it wasn't like a very comfortable living arrangement. Like I wake up early, so I was like sitting on the ground, like, you know, letting him get his like 2 hours of sleep, and out of like a mid sound asleep, he just like woke up and he was like, I can't keep living like this, and then just fell back asleep. And like, well, I thought after the last guy that had Spider-Man bed sheets, I'd be done with this, but here we are. All right, guys, thank you so much. You're great. Thank you. Get home safe tonight. Give it up for Jean.
One more time for Jillian, everyone. All right. Are we ready for the main event? Whoa, whoa, whoa. That was a tepid applause, okay? I'm looking at you, and I'm looking for the guy who's all about temple basketball over here. Are we ready for the main event? Alrighty then. He's a hometown hero. Back from conquering the West Coast. He is gracing us with his presence. Please keep it going for the one, the only, Chris Haas, everyone.
Yeah. Come back to Pennsylvania, do a fucking show. That's a great idea. Except for the fucking weather. Dudes, hello. How's it going? Before we get going, let's just hear it for the other comics that came out before me, right? Incredible. Nick, that was Nick's first time doing stand-up comedy. Whoa. 10 minutes. 10 minutes his first time. My first time, I barely lasted 10 seconds. Not much has changed. Fucking Gene and Marc. Way funnier than me, so sorry. It's all downhill from here. Jillian and Ethan are like, I don't even think they're of age. 20, 19. I did not have the ambition to do stand-up comedy when I was 19. I had the ambition to walk around in circles and cry while I listened to the Garden State soundtrack. How much has changed? But it's great to be back. I've been back in Pennsylvania for a week, having a great time doing Pennsylvania things. My sister took me to Sheets for the first time. I'd never been there. And I liked it, but the whole time I felt like I was cheating on Wawa. Like, oh, meatball sub. I hope Wawa's not looking. Oh, meatball sub. I'm staying with my parents in Lancaster County. They retired there because they lived in Chester County for several years, and then they... Yeah, they decided, they're like, no, there's not enough burning crosses, right? They went to Lancaster County, little different demographic than I'm used to in Los Angeles. Whiter than a Trump rally. Whiter than a bucket of cum. Whiter than the sheets the abandoned has in his trunk. Hey! Controversy. But I've been having a good time. I went to Shady Maple, which is also pretty white, but the only other thing in there that was dark besides me was the Scrapple. Stupid. But I've been having time, my parents are here for the first time in the night seeing me do stand-up comedy. It's pretty exciting.
Whoa.
Yeah, pretty exciting. You know, and all last week and the weeks leading up to the show, I was like, this is amazing. My mom's going to see me do stand-up comedy for the first time. This is so cool. And then last week, I thought, oh, I say fuck a lot in my act. I'm going to be saying fuck a lot in front of my mom. And then 2 days ago, I was thinking, oh, I say pussy a lot in my act. I'm going to be saying pussy a lot in front of my mom. Then an hour ago backstage, I was like, oh, I say dick-looking cunts not a lot in my act. Oh, well. Next time, I pick a different kid at the orphanage, folks. Let's see, where are we? Let me get my notes here that I'm not going to look at, but yeah, comedy. So some of you I know from long ago, I graduated 10 years ago. A few things have changed. I don't have everything I used to have, namely hair. I got married 10 years ago, full head of hair, very happy. This is what I'm working with now. There's no real positive way to spin this.
It's overrated.
All this is good for our cruel jokes and a place for a bird to build a nest. But when it really stopped growing, I was looking at myself in the mirror, just really depressed. Like, oh, the comb over's not working, the ponytail's not working, the hats are obvious. My wife comes up behind me and says, would you stop, don't worry about it, you're very handsome. My 16-year-old daughter walks by and goes, yeah, a handsome clown. She's got no reason to lie. Wives who want their husbands to stop drinking so much in the dark, reading James Joyce and weeping, they have reason to lie. But I'm a dad now. I've got a 16-year-old daughter, and I've got a 7-year-old son. And, you know, my daughter, she's at that age, a little moody, you know. I realize I don't know much about a teenage girl. Don't have any way to relate. But she's getting into music now. And she said to me, Dad, I'm thinking about being in a garage band. I think about being in a punk band. And I said, oh, what? And I was in a few punk bands, rock bands when I was a kid. And she goes, you? We're in a band? And in 1 second, all of rock and roll had been threatened for her. Sex Pistols, Beatles, Bruce Springsteen, Bob Dylan, all threatened because her dad was in a band. And I thought I could use this as a teaching moment, you know, and kind of say, well, when people change, people aren't always what they, you know, so I was trying to be really nice about it, not defensive, but all that came out is, hey, I wasn't always a big fat daddy. So 1 second I made it worse and I'm even lamer. But I have a new name for my new solo jazz act. Hey, cats and kittens, come on down, hear me blow my horn, it's me, the big fat daddy. But, you know, I'm trying to relate to my daughter, and I was trying to be affectionate with her the other day, and I was trying to snuggle her, you know, and she goes, get off me, Dad, I don't want to be snuggled by you, I don't want to be cuddled. And my wife rushes into my defense and says, you be nice to your father, he's trying to be sensitive and sweet. We touch each other in this family. If any of you guys are ever in Los Angeles, you're feeling a little lonely, like you don't need to be touched. Got a pretty willing wife and 2 kids in my place. But my son's really into DC comics, and he likes to dress up everywhere we go, and he always wants me to cosplay with him when we go to conventions and movies and stuff, but it's hard for me to know who to cosplay, because as you can tell, I'm a big fat water rat, and I can't even fit in my own clothes anymore. I can't very well fucking fit in the Batman's. But I solved the problem for myself, shaved my head, put on a mask, boom, out of shape, bang. I'm out of shape, bang. I'm gonna break your back, Batman. And then you have my permission to die. But first, I'm gonna finish melting cheese on this pancake. But my son will stay in character all day long in his costume. And he came up to me dressed in full Batman costume last week. And he says, Daddy, I'm Batman. As if the belt and the mask and the utility belt didn't give it away. Daddy, would you like to know Two-Face's real name? I said, yeah, buddy, what is it? Two-Face's real name is Harvey Dent. That's right, buddy. That's right. Good job. Daddy, would you like to know the Joker's real name? Yeah. What's the Joker's real name? Daddy, the Joker's real name is Heath Ledger. Gotta give that fucking kid a cutback for that joke. Oh, man. So, let's see. I'm not a very religious person, Sherlock, I know. And But I, you know, this is a fairly religious area growing up in Pennsylvania. And there was a religious song, a gospel song I always heard that made me laugh when I was a kid. And I sing it sometimes to my wife to annoy her because I'm an idiot. And the song, and I can't even tell you about it without laughing. The song is about this guy and he dies and he goes to heaven and he meets Jesus at the pearly gates. And Jesus says to him, which is the chorus of the song, "Thank you for giving to the Lord. I'm so glad you gave." So I sing this to my wife just to get on her nerves. And my son's getting to the age where he starts asking questions. He says, "Dad, what's the deal with thank you for coming to the Lord?" I said, "Well, some people believe there's a God that watches over us and has a set of moral codes. And in the Christian religion, they believe he sent his son to earth to die for our sins, which he did, and he was redeemed, and then he went back Santa Claus, chocolate bunnies, Mel Gibson." Not the greatest explanation of Christianity, I'll grant you. But all my son took from that was that it was a good thing that Jesus died. So now when it's least expected, and least appropriate, my son will come out with, "Thank you for killing Jesus Christ." What are you gonna do? Kids. Let's check my name. I'm not gonna do that one. Offending Christians. Religion. Since we talked about religion, let's talk about the election. It brings people together. Comedy brings people together. Holidays don't, Facebook posts don't, comedy brings people together. You know who I feel bad in this whole thing? This is who I feel bad for. The word Trump. What did that poor verb do to anybody else? I mean, it's never going to be the same now. It's like, "Well, your President Trump's mine." "Oh, what's your president? Grabbing my pussy? Let me show you my Trump card." "What's your Trump card? Racism?"
"No, it's a Hillary card, you asshole."
"Yeah,
that's right. Go ahead, let's hear it."
I don't think I'm in LA anymore. Woo, Pennsylvania! Woo! Yeah, woo! So funny, man! I didn't expect that. Oh boy.
I think we're in Kansas.
Yeah. Comedy brings people together. I was about to make fun of Hillary because I don't like her either, but now you don't get it. That guy just inspired me to say something I said I would never say. No, I can't say I'm with her. I can't do it. Fuck! I don't like Hillary either. Oh, God. I didn't expect that on my own show. That's kind of cool. Sorry, no disrespect. I'm from LA. We're really liberal out there. We have contests to see who's more liberal. It's like, "I'm eating kale. I'm blowing a transgender person. I'm more liberal." Let's move away from that. Oh my God, where are we at? Offending people, getting heckled, getting beat up after the show and hung by a rope. And then after he hangs me by a rope, he'll go on Facebook and said, "I bullied him. I bullied him with my tolerance." Okay. So, I wanted to do something special for you guys. I guess that was it. But I have some jokes. I have some jokes that are in a folder and it's marked, "Don't ever do these jokes. They're not funny. They're stupid. They will never work." So I thought I'd do them for you guys. Sure, nice crowd. I haven't really ever practiced these, so my delivery might drop a little bit. Hey. Are there any YouTube fans in the audience tonight? Boy, do I have a joke for you. There's a Korean restaurant in my neighborhood called U2. I've been there several times and I've looked through the menu, but I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I tried to order a Bloody Mary, but all they gave me was a bloody Sunday. Are there any Catholics in the audience tonight? Boy, do I have a joke for you. Whenever it's Ash Wednesday and I see an attractive woman with ash on her forehead, I'm always tempted to say, "Hey babe, nice ash." Are there any John Cusack fans in the audience? Oh boy. Do I have a joke for you? John Cusack keeps asking me to join his improv troupe, but I'm a little apprehensive because I don't know what he'll do. He might say anything. Controversy.
He'd be better off dead.
I was going. One time I was going to apply to work at an adult bookstore, but I realized I would have been like a drunk working in a bar. Are there any fans of the restaurant Denny's in the audience tonight?
Yeah!
Oh boy. Do I have a joke for you? I was eating at Denny's the other night, but that's not the joke. I was eating at Denny's the other night, and the waiter came to my table to take my order, and I said I want the 5-star triple grand slam diarrhea sampler. But that's not the joke. The waiter asked me if I wanted the 5-star triple grand slam diarrhea sampler with the vomit side up and a side of heart disease. And I said it didn't matter, but to make sure that it had a healthy amount of bacon bits and cheddar cheese that rivaled the creamy ecstasy of 69ing on a water slide. Oh. That's not the joke. The waiter said, "You're eating like you're trying to die." I said, "Don't be macabre. I don't want to die." The waiter said, "Irrespective of what you want, you will die. Probably alone. In a misbegotten puddle of benign, omnipresent, inevitably atavistic failure, matched only by the cold and sudden sharp intake of your final breath." Nullifying meaning and ending the already shallow and hollow superfluous existence that you're living. And then he said, "Also, the milkshakes here are out of this world." But that's not the joke. Let me tell you the joke. The other night I was eating at Denny's, and when I left, there was a pair of crutches leaning alongside the restaurant. So I took the crutches someplace they could be of use. I took them to IHOP. Are there any fans of the Stephen King book It in the audience tonight?
Yeah!
Joke for you. Whenever someone says the phrase Pennywise and pound foolish, I think of Pennywise the clown having a new sidekick, Pound Foolish. But Pound Foolish the clown is the nicest clown you'll ever meet. He would never dream of murdering children. Those are the jokes that don't work. Now we'll do some James Taylor tunes. I've seen hecklers and I've seen rain. You may notice I'm a stand-up comic that does his stand-up comedy standing up. When I was a kid, I used to watch Bill Cosby. And I couldn't understand why he sat down when he was doing his comedy. But now I know. He was just saving his energy. For rape. Whenever I make a rape joke and I see a guy in the audience nodding knowingly with half a smile on his face, I think, well, he's a guy who likes to rape. So, anybody on Facebook here? I don't understand. Whenever I go on Facebook, it's either really great things or really horrible things. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm ruling the world, I'm doing great, look at how pretty I am, or my husband's in surgery, please pray for him. It's hard to go from one thing to another. And I get a little nervous when they ask me to send them their prayers, because it's for very serious stuff. You know, my wife is really sick, my daughter's having surgery, I'm out of work, send me your prayers. I would feel terrible if I sent my prayers to somebody and they didn't work. I would feel awful, because that means my prayers are inadequate. And I don't realize, well, maybe I should just leave this, it's too fucking religious. It's fucking Pennsylvania. Oh, I'm glad to be back. And I'm gonna go through it. I don't realize when they're asking for your prayers, it's for something really serious. But when they're blessed, it's for something kind of easy that anybody could do. So, send me your prayers. I took a walk on the beach with my dog today, feeling blessed. If you're blessed, what do you need my prayers for? You're blessed. I'm not blessed. And I need my prayers. Prayers have been keeping me sexually satisfied for years. My wife doesn't pee on me because she wants to. I had to pray for that. But again, it's always very, like, you know, innocuous things. Saw my bestie for the first time in a week, feeling blessed. That moment when you see your girlfriend for the first time in a week, hashtag feeling blessed. I just want some honest ones, you know, like, my herpes sore is finally settled, feeling blessed. Had a little trouble on the metro train today, feeling racist. That moment when you fall off the wagon, hashtag meth. That moment when you pull out at the wrong time, hashtag awkward facial. Bringing people together. But I think I have a lot of friends on Facebook. One of the biggest divides in this country, I think, is just people not seeing things from the same perspective, which is totally fine. Everybody has a perspective. And I have a lot of friends who are not necessarily conservative, who are possibly liberal, or just, you know, that are into guns. And I don't understand guns. They scare me. But I've talked with them and been able to get a little of their perspective. However, they always seem to post pictures of their new guns right after a shoot, right after a school shooting, right after something horrible has happened. Here's my gun, which is totally fine. I have no problem with that. But if they're going to post pictures of their guns, I should be allowed to post pictures of my dick. It's kind of the same thing. It's my most valued possession that proves that I'm a man. Looks pretty much like all the other ones you've ever seen. It's not nearly as big as impressive as I think it is. And it discharges something nobody wants. I should be able to post that. That's my right. All right, all that stuff's done with now. The rest of the set's gonna be fun. Let's get Nick Karabetsos back up here for a second. Where are you, Nick? Oh, there he is. Holy shit. I brought you out too soon. I gotta set it up, but just stay here. Have some water.
Me too soon.
Have some water. So, anyone here watch The Walking That was a bit. Anybody here watch The Walking Dead? So I guess something big happened on The Walking Dead two weeks ago or something. Everybody was talking about it, and people were getting it spoiled for them. And I don't know, I don't watch The Walking Dead. I'm not really into zombies. If I wanted to watch a bunch of brain dead zombies, I would have watched the presidential debates. Hey, fella, comedy! Because I don't like Hillary either. I'm not a snowflake faggot pussy liberal. I don't like either of them.
Bernie all the way.
Bernie all the way. Hell yeah. Anyway, so if you go on social media during the show and it gets spoiled for you, it's kind of your fault. When Game of Thrones is on, I turn my phone off, I'm dead to the world, and I sit in my apartment and make little maps and arrows on my Westeros posters. But that's just me. But if someone just spoils it for you, walking up to you at work or something, that's on them. But you have to be able to guard against that. So I have a very scientific research way to avoid spoilers. This is how to avoid spoilers. Nick has seen The Walking Dead. I haven't. So you're gonna say, hey Chris, I'm gonna say, hey Nick, you're gonna say, have you seen The Walking Dead? You can use this. This is how to avoid spoilers.
Hey Chris.
Hey Nick.
Hey, have you seen-
Shut the fuck! Okay. Sorry, I'm totally thrown. Comedy's about honesty. So I'm gonna tell you, I'm totally thrown. I had to, I keep checking my list. I memorized it all and practiced it in my parents' bathroom last night. But, growing up brown in a sea of cum, you get a little nervous and people call you assholes. Oh my God. Oh, this is good. Redskins. Okay, this is good. It's not going to rethink. With all the controversy over the name of the Washington Redskins, doesn't anybody else notice that the Washington Redskins have the same colors as House Gryffindor? Why don't they just change their name to the Washington Gryffindors? With one stroke of a pen, they'd go from hated racist to totally awesome. Any Harry Potter fans here? All right, good. This will work. Why the fuck didn't Hogwarts stop the Holocaust from happening?
Oh, God.
It happened in the same universe. They're just in the wizarding world. When the Holocaust was happening, Dumbledore was a fairly young wizard. Why didn't he just poof himself into the Muggle world and take, you know, Hitler out with a Cruciatus curse? At no point was it McGonagall like, hey, Dumbledore, are you going to do anything about this guy with the mustache systematically massacring half of Europe? Oh, sorry, I got a big Quidditch match that weekend. Dumbledore out. Fucking selfish wizard prick he is. Oh man, I gotta chuck it again. Bomb. Hiroshima wants its bomb back. Oh God. Oh, the Jungle Book, that's a good one. Has anyone seen the new Jungle Book?
New one.
Actually seen it?
The new one.
Has anyone seen the original Jungle Book?
Yeah! Yeah.
All right, yeah. So I took my kids to the Jungle Book. It was awesome. I loved it. My favorite character is Shere Khan the tiger. And I know he's supposed to be the villain, but fuck you, I like tigers. My son calls him Tigies, so now I call him Tigies. I'm making that up. I call him Tigies because I love Tigies. They're beautiful creatures. And I don't think he's the villain. If you want to know what a character is, look at what the characters want. That's what they tell you in every comedy, in every writing class. So Mowgli the man cub wants to just live in the jungle, cause civil war because he's so deluded. He thinks he's a fucking cub. Baloo the bear just wants to sing some hippie bullshit and lie down the river and never work a day in his life. Ka the snake wants you to trust in him while he lulls you into sleep before he eats you. King Louis the ape wants the power of fire and to rule over all of man. All Shere Khan wants is lunch. All Shere Khan wants is lunch. And if being realistic makes you crazy, then I guess I'm evil. But I just don't understand, why would we want to go against the tiger to save the man cub? You know how many tigers are left? 3,200. How many man cubs? Billions! A lot of man cubs are going to grow up to be a bunch of man creeps. Fuck them. Let them get killed. I'm all for the tiger. Speaking of Disney classics, I showed my kid The Lion King. And I'm watching the scene where Scar is singing the hyenas, be prepared. You know, my teeth and ambitions are bared, be prepared. Why? Why would you want anybody to be prepared? Think of his plan. His plan is so specific. He needs Mufasa, the wildebeest, and the hyenas to all be in just the right place at the right time. Why would he want anybody to be prepared? You don't think any of the hyenas talked about that the next day? No, oh, you fucking giraffes, you gotta listen to this. Scar had this song the other day. Scar's place, it was fabulous. Be prepared, wonderful dance number. You might want to tell the elephants, you might want to be fucking prepared. His teeth and ambitions are bare, that's putting it mildly. The song was going to make any sense, they would have said, I hope the wildebeest are conveniently scared. Oh shit, I hope no one's prepared. The song makes no fucking sense. Does anyone here like karaoke? Yeah. I was at a karaoke place at a dive bar in the valley a couple weeks ago. It was a total true story. It was your normal fare for dive bar karaoke in the valley. Drunk Don't Stop Believing, Drunk Bohemian Rhapsody, More Drunk Bohemian Rhapsody. Fuck Bohemian Rhapsody.
Fuck you. It's Ben.
Hi, Ben. Nice job. Oh, that was awesome. Dive Bar in the Valley. So this guy gets up to sing The Boxer by Simon and Garfunkel. Not your typical choice for karaoke Dive Bar in the Valley. If you're not familiar, it's a very lovely song of being lost and found in New York City. I'm just a poor boy, my story is seldom told, so on and so forth. So he sings that for about a minute and a half. There's a really good lyric for lyric, note for note version of The Boxer. Then he gets to the part where it goes, I've been looking for a job, but I get no offers. Just to come on from the whores on 7th Avenue. Now remember, he's been singing a good note-for-note, lyric-for-lyric version of The Boxer for about a minute and a half. And then, I swear to you, he says, I've been looking for a job, but I get no offers. Just to come on from the whores on 7th Avenue. I do declare these fucking whores, they gave me AIDS. These lying fucking whores, they gave me AIDS. And nobody else says anything. And I'm at the bar, just like, fuck. I'm looking around and nobody says anything. And then he just keeps going on and on about AIDS giving them whores. And I'm looking around like, has nobody in this dive bar in the valley ever heard The Boxer before? And if they had, does it make sense you would have a nice song about, you know, getting lost and found in New York City for a minute and a half and then going into a diatribe about getting AIDS or whores? And I'm a little offended. Why would you not do a nice Paul Simon song? And then it gets to the part where they go, lie, 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 lie. And he goes, and they lied. And the whores, they fucking lied. And they lied. And the whores, they fucking lied. They fucking lied. And then he leaves. And nobody says anything. And I'm looking around. I'm enthralled. I'm entranced. Who is this guy? Why would he do that? Why would anybody do that? Does he just get up going from bar to bar ruining classic rock songs? Does he wake up like, what song am I going to ruin tonight? I already ruined Moonshadow. Blackbird, I'm going to ruin Blackbird. Then I'm going to do that horse they fucking lied to. Wait till they get all out of this. So my daughter came home from her first day at ninth grade PE last year. They're playing football. She says, Dad, the way you taught me how to throw a football was wrong. So what do you mean? I said, I threw the football, and they said I wasn't throwing the football the right way. The way you taught me is wrong all these years. And I thought, my kids are paying attention to what I say. This changes everything. And I thought, how should I know how to throw a football? Just talk to the way my dad taught me. How the hell does he know? He's a fucking English teacher. If you want like some depressive haikus, we're the guys to go to. I'm really sports minded. And then I thought, you know, I could have played sports. I always liked sports. I never played because I was like an actor. And I was like, oh, I can't do that. But I could have played sports. In fact, I did. I played some pickup tackle football one time. And it was really intense. We were tackling each other, but then somebody broke his leg and I was heavy and that year fell on the roof and can't very well do a show-stopping rendition of If I Were a Rich Man with a broken fucking leg, you know, can you? So I thought maybe I can have my friend Kyle show how to throw a football. I have this friend Kyle, he's really nice. I call him up when I need something done around the house that a man needs to be able to do. The car has to be fixed, something has to, you know, I don't know anything about tools. He's a Republican Christian cop. And if you don't have a Republican Christian cop lying around, they are so useful. He's so nice, and he always comes over because he's the nicest guy ever. And then he gets under the hood of my car. He's fixing my car, and he doesn't mind that I don't even know the names of tools, that I'm just pacing around chewing, you know, cheese and talking about Game of Thrones theories. And then when he's done, he plays video games with my kids. And he's the fucking Michael Jordan of video games. I'm not good at video games. The last one I played was Duck Hunt. And the duck won. And I thought maybe he could show them, because I don't know anything about sports, but I do know what it's like to be a broken-hearted lunatic, because I am a lifelong Philadelphia Eagles fan. I don't remember a time I wasn't an Eagles fan. I'm not religious. The Eagles are my religion. I remember when I learned how to laugh. I remember when I knew I wanted to be a comedian. I remember when I was like, you know what? I like food. I don't remember not being an Eagles fan. And there's no logic to it. It's just because of where I am. And because of where other people live, like Texas, New York, and Washington, I hate them for no apparent reason, except I was told to. Now I'll tell you what I mean by a broken-hearted lunatic. And it's nice to be here, because when I say this in LA, they don't know what they're talking about. They hear an Eagles fan, they're like, oh, the team that never won a Super Bowl? Oh, really? I thought we won 5. Thanks for pointing that out for me. Thank you. My father is a very well-mannered, nice man, but he is also a broken-hearted lunatic. Here's an example of the lunatic. Miracle at the New Meadowlands, DeSean Jackson walk-off punt. I'm in the mountains of Vermont, I don't get reception. My phone rings. My phone rings when I get down from the mountains. This is what I hear. You have one new message. Press 1 to hear your message. Here's the message. Can you believe it? Oh my God! Can you believe it? I tell you. Call me back. Here's the brokenhearted part. We lose to the Patriots in the Super Bowl, 2005. I come home to the kitchen. I watch the second half with a friend, so I come home. The kitchen's dark. My dad's standing by himself. And I say, hey, what are you gonna do, man? He doesn't look at me, he just says, well, They're never gonna win the big one. Not in my lifetime. And out he walks. Broken-hearted lunatic. And we always hear the same thing. My grandfather said it to me, and now I say it to my son. This is gonna be our year. Remember when we had that really good team 10 years ago? And we thought we were gonna win all these things and we lost all those championships? The Giants have won two since then! I fucking hate it so much. I'm not telling you any jokes, this is just therapy for me at this point. This is gonna be our year. It was never our year. It wasn't our year in January 2004 when I went to see them play the Green Bay Packers, divisional round in Philadelphia. You were there?
I was there.
Oh, that's amazing. Great game. They all said the Packers are gonna win because Brett Favre's dad died and they were a team of destiny, jerk me off upside down. And of course we get behind in the game because we always make things harder for ourselves. And we are able to get it to overtime. And I'm in the 700 level. And the Packers take it down methodically. All they have to do is get like one more pass. They're in field goal range. You can field goal overtime. Game is over. And I say in my loud 17-year-old bravado, Dawkins is gonna get an interception. And then inexplicably, Brett Favre takes the ball, throws it up for anybody to catch, and Dawkins got an interception! And the whole place starts going crazy, and some 700-pound guy from South Philly picks him and goes, I fucking love this guy, this fucking guy, Santa! And the whole stadium is screaming, and I'm going fucking nuts, my light is glassing before my eyes, and Dawkins stood so high you could see him from the sky. And he stood so high you could see him from outside the stadium, and he stood so high you could see him down Broad Street, and it was real, and it was beatific, and it happened. And of course, the next week we lost the NFC Championship. There's not the fucking point of the story. My dad said to me one time when they got beaten by the 49ers really bad, he goes, they keep playing like this. I'm not gonna watch this team. Shut the fuck up, Dad. You're gonna keep watching this team. I've been watching them lose. You've been watching them lose. My grandfather probably listened to them lose on the fucking radio. We're not gonna stop watching this team. This is gonna be our year. Wasn't our year in 1995 when we played the Dallas Cowboys. Yep, the Dallas Cowboys. I can't say this anywhere else. The worst piece of shit on the planet. Not the Dallas Cowboys. The worst piece of shit motherfucking lunatics, not Dallas Cowboys fans. The worst piece of shit, corpse fucking, piece of shit gobbling cock monster motherfuckers in the world are Dallas Cowboys fans who were born in Pennsylvania. And if there's any of you in here tonight, fuck you. And if there's any of you in there out there in the cold, fuck you. Dallas Cowboys walking around calling. They've been in LA, like, Chris, why do you like the Cowboys so much? They call themselves America's team. They call themselves that. They just woke up like, we're America's team. And you know, they don't have a dome and they don't have an open stadium. They have a little hole. You know why? They have a reason. So that God can watch his team play. So we're playing the Dallas Cowboys in 1995, and of course, we get behind because we never make things easy for ourselves. And we crawl back into it, and we just gotta get a field goal, but we gotta stop them first. Dave Emmitt Smith, one of the greatest rushers of all time. Fourth and one. They hand it off to Emmitt Smith. He runs up, the Eagles go pick him up, they pick him up, and they stuff him down, and it's done, and it's done! But no, the two-minute warning. The two-minute warning didn't get off, so they give him another shot. One more shot to rethink this. And they run the same fucking play because they don't respect us. They run the same fucking play because they don't respect us. And they hand it off to Emmitt Smith, and he goes up, and they pick him up again, and they shut him down again, and they can't take it away from the Eagles, and the Eagles win, and I'm going crazy, and my life is going before my eyes, and the stadium is going wild, and everyone in Philadelphia, everyone in Pennsylvania is screaming, except for those dickheads up in Pittsburgh, but everybody is screaming. And the Eagles stand so high you can see from the sky, and they stand so high you can see him outside the stadium, and they stand so high you can see him down Broad Street. It was beatific, it was real when it happened. And then the Cowboys won the Super Bowl that year, but that's not the point of the story. Now I live in Los Angeles, and I watch them at an Eagles pub of a bunch of South Philly and just Pennsylvania people that live in LA, but they come to this pub to be with other Pennsylvania people because they want to be miserable for 4 hours. This is how it goes. Santa Monica, Eagles pub. Fucking Eagles, let's go. I had eye surgery 2 years ago. Couldn't see very well. The Eagles wore their white jerseys the first six games. We're playing the Seattle Seahawks. I just had eye surgery. My food comes. Food TV. Food, TV. I see a guy in a white jersey running toward the end zone. Food, TV, white jersey, end zone. Go, 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 yes, yes. I was rooting for the wrong fucking team. It was Russell Wilson. We were wearing our green jerseys. The place was silent. This is a place where if you walk in with the wrong jersey, the chant is, get the fuck out, you suck dick. Get the fuck out, you suck dick. My wife, good, look at me. I've never even talked about this with her. This is the first time I'm ever talking about this. And I brushed myself off and I went back because that's what we do. Because it's not about fantasy football for us. It's not about just winning. It's about how you play. And it's about when they tell you you can't do it, you stand so high they can see you from the sky and you get all the energy of Brian Dawkins, Reggie White, Randall Cunningham, Chuck Bender, Derek, and you stand so tall and you look them straight in the eye and you say, fuck you. This is going to be our year. Yeah. All right. We're getting to the end. And Frank Sinatra with a beer. My dad, one of my favorite stories about my dad, which I'll share with you now, because why not? See if he heckles me. fuck. It was senior year of high school. And I'm trying to figure out who to ask to the prom, because believe it or not, the girls weren't beating down the doors, because ugly and obnoxious wasn't in that year. Who knew? And I'm with my buddy. Well, she won't go out with me. She won't go out with me. No, she would never go to the prom with me. And my dad strolls, he's a very smart man, strolls in from the kitchen, looking like he's going to say something very helpful. And he says, you know, Christopher, it would be amazing if you could just think. If you could take Cameron Diaz to the prom, right? I mean, because he just assists, my God. And then he leaves. Oh, yeah, Dad, thanks. I'll just take Cameron Diaz to the prom. Why didn't I think of that? And I'll hop on Amy's the Messenger and see what Scarlett Johansson's up to this week. For my next trick, I'm going to fly. So my parents came out to visit LA, and you do not realize how many strip clubs are on Sunset Boulevard. Until you were cruising down it with your parents from Pennsylvania. And my mom's, you know, they're not that familiar with LA, so my mom's saying everything out the window. Oh, Whiskey a Go-Go, In-N-Out Burger, live nudes. Then my dad chimes in, live nudes, it's better than dead nudes. I think they need to change the name of strip clubs, the marquees. You know, girls, 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 go. We get it, there's girls inside, thanks so much. I want to see our rolling marquees, if anybody's paying attention. Girls, 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 guy, girls, 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 girls. You go to talk these girls dancing, just one guy. But not like an attractive male dancer, some fun guy looks like me, comes out naked. Hey. I'm guy. You want a lap dance? Great, hit it! We had some big news. I got the beginnings of a blowjob last week. It's from my wife. It's one of those things, blowjobs kind of stop after. Anybody married? They're like, why would I say that now? I'm not getting blown. It's one of those things that stops after marriage. I'm not complaining, just one of those cliches. I'm not one of those guys complaining, it just happens to be true. Blowjobs are being extinct. I see more dinosaurs than I see blowjobs. Because I do watch Jurassic Park at least once a year. So I say that joke a lot, and my wife's getting tired of it. So a few weeks ago, she said, I'm tired of you making that stupid joke. I love you. I don't mind going down on you. So I go in the bedroom. She takes my pants down. Gets my piece in her hand. Starts looking at it. Like she's never seen one before. I said, everything okay? Just, I love you. I don't mind going down on you. But have you had a shower today? Because your penis is usually stinky. Now, I should have stopped everything right there. Because there's not really any coming back from your penis is usually stinky. There's no way to make that romantic. Like, oh, baby, I know my penis is usually stinky. Tonight, you are about to suck on a penis that is, wait for it, not stinky. Oh, we get to suck a non-stinky penis? I'm dripping wet now. Doesn't happen. So, she gives me a blowjob for about a minute seven. Minute six. It's not really a blowjob anymore. It's a blow task at this point. She takes my dick out of her mouth, exasperated. There, satisfied? Oh yeah, totally satisfied. As long as satisfied means crippled with embarrassment or riddled with obsequious sorrow, totally satisfied. Define satisfied, wife of mine. Well, I can't blame her. I wouldn't want to blow me either. No blowjobs for me. That's why God invented porn. Does anyone here masturbate the internet porn on their phone? Oh, I guess I'm the only one here that does that! Isn't it tragic when you're masturbating the porn on your phone and then right before you come, the video ends? Because what do? You go to the next video? Do you take it back to the beginning? Do you just go to your favorite part? Because we all have a favorite part. This happened to me last week. I was watching this beautiful, moving and insightful, Big Beautiful Woman Comes Love Milk video. And I'm watching this woman just get brutally explored by 9 inches of curious black cock. And then the video ends. But luckily there was something I could click on called Related Videos, which is good, because I don't have to do a whole new search. Because I like something very specific. I like curvy women. But sometimes when you type in curvy, you don't get curvy. You get a skinny girl with big fake tits. I don't want that shit. I'm just trying to come. Sometimes when you type in curvy, you don't get curvy. You get a 600-pound grandmother getting gang-fucked by her stepsons. I don't need that shit. I'm just trying to come. I need big, natural breasts, a soft yet sizable stomach, and a big ass, an ass that I could get lost in, an ass that could cut off my air supply. So I look at related videos, and something called fat domination. Perfect, click, I'm in. Say, you show me a big girl looking for dominate, I show you cum. I can't help it. I am who I am. I like what I like. I'm just a chunky ducky troll trying to see what I can see. So I look at fat domination. It's this big gal dancing around naked. This guy's lying on the floor. And she starts to squat right on his face. And I realize it's a little strange. I misread the name of the video. It doesn't say fat domination. It says fart domination. Oh. And then, of course, at that point, I turned up the volume and kept watching. And so would all of you. What am I supposed to do? Turn this video off and go back to my boring life? Get out of your fucking minds! So I watched the video, and sure enough, this gal sits on this guy's face and rips a fart juicier than a Capri Sun in July. And at that point, I turned the video off, disgusted and offended. Plus, I'd already come and I had to clean off my chest. Thank you very much, everybody! Thank you very much for coming out. Thank you. One more time for all the other comics. It's here for Gene.
Okay. Thank you very much for coming out. Leave a dollar in the basket. This place is awesome. This was amazing. Get home safe. Neuter your pets. Have a good night.
Have you heard about the science of the Rams? The science of the Rams. The science of the Rams. They came from outer space, so we cut them up to learn the Rammy secrets. Have you heard about the science of the Rams? The science of the Rams. The science of the Rams. They came from outer space. Now they're all freaking dead because we cut them up to learn the Rammy secrets. This is the science of the Rams, the science of the Rams, the science of the Rams, the science of the Rams. Bleh.